Come and move how you wanna move. why don't you
say what you want to say
and have your way,
man?
That's all it is. Why don't you
do what you want to do?
Come and
move how you want to move.
Why don't you
say what you want to say
and have your way,
man?
Let's go. Cause you are my one. Come on, clap. You are my one
desire.
You are my one
desire.
Come and have your way. This is what we came for. This is what we're here for. Jesus, we love you. Come on, do you love him this morning? Hey, this is what we came for. This is what we're here for. Jesus, we love you. Come on, can you clap your hands? That's it. Say, this is what we came for.
This is what we came for.
Love you. Clap.
Jesus,
cause you're so lovable, Jesus. This is what we came for.
This is what we came for. This is what we here for.
Jesus, we love you.
Jesus, we love.
Come on, not just for what he can do for you, but just because of who
this
he is.
Is what we came for. This is what we here for.
Jesus, we love you.
Jesus, we love you.
Hey. Come on, let's sing it again. This is what we came for.
This is what we came for.
I love on you. Come on, all over this room, can you just begin to pour out your love on them? Come on, open up your mouth. Pour out your love on them. Pour out your praise on them. No matter how your week has been, he's still worthy of it. He's still worthy of this praise. This is what we came for. This is what we're here for. Jesus, be loved. Come on, can you just say, I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you that I love you more than anything. This is what we came for. This is what we're here for. This is what we came for. I don't know about you, but I showed up expecting a miracle. I showed up expecting a move of God, but the only way to get that is to pour out your praise on them. This is what we came for. This is what we're here for. To lavish our love on you. Come on, just say, I love you, Jesus. There's nobody like you. He reigns forever. He reigns as King.
Yes,
come on, can you clap your hands like this? Ah! Let's go. Everybody say, oh. Lift your voice and say, I trust in your name, Jesus. He's able to save and deliver us. So we put our hope in your name, Jesus. Say blessing.
Let's go!
came in here believing God for. But I don't know if you've tried it in your own strength and realized that it just won't work. But things that are impossible with man are made possible with God. So I dare you to think about that thing that you are believing God for, whether it's healing, whether it's breakthrough, whether it's your freedom, whether it's a financial miracle. Can you just, for about 5 seconds, just think about it. Get it in your mind. Get it in your mind. Get it in your mind. And can you believe that it's already done before you see it? That's the part. I need you to believe that it's already done before it's done. So the next time we declare this, I need you to declare that with that thing already done in your mind, because all things are possible. Keep it singing right here. We say, our God is in control. Say, steadfast. Say, nothing yet. Because our God. Come on, believe for us. Say, our God. Say, steadfast. Say nothing is. Yeah. Hey, because our God, I think we can declare it louder. Believe it. Say, our God is. That's it. Steadfast. Yeah, yeah. Nothing is impossible. Our God. I think we got, well, I feel something rising. Say, our God. Steadfast. Cause our God, can we shout it together? Let's go, let's go. See, our God is there.
Our God is in control.
Stand fast.
Stand fast, unmovable.
Nothing is impossible.
Nothing's impossible.
Cause our God,
our God,
come on, believe it. Our God is in.
Our God is in control.
Stand fast.
Stand fast, unmovable.
Nothing is impossible. Say, all things are possible. You suck. It sounds like I'm in a room full of believers this morning. Say, our God. Say, all things are possible. Do you believe it? Do you receive it? Because our God. Can you say this right here? Say this, say. Nothing's impossible. You say. You sound like you believe it. Cause our God. Shout it. Nothing's impossible. Say nothing is. Say nothing is. Cause I think y'all like that one. Say it again. Say nothing. Sing it, sing. Shout it, shout. Can you join that with hands clapping? Say nothing. That's the sound, that's the sound, that's the sound. Say nothing. Let's put them all together. Let's go, Pastor Johnny. Say, our God is in.
Our God is in control.
Stand fast.
Stand fast, unmovable.
Nothing is.
Nothing is impossible.
Cause our God, he reigns. Say, our God is in.
Our God is in control.
Stand fast.
Stand fast, unmovable.
Nothing is.
Nothing is impossible.
Cause our God. To our God forever and ever.
Yeah.
All of the honor, all of our praise is His. God is yours forever. So we sing hallelujah. Come on, that's your church. We sing said that it's his forever. Hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah is to our God. We say every praise is to our God. The next part says, God, my God, my healer. Come on, you know. God, my deliverer. Can you shout this one? Say, yes, yes, yes,
yes.
Say, God. Say you are God,
God, my Savior.
You are my God,
God, my
You have been that and more to me,
God, my
say, yes,
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 yes.
Come on, shout, yes,
yes.
Come on, do you agree? Yes,
yes.
Wave your hands, say. Come on, you sing it. Every with one, every praise. When you see me shouting, with my hands waving, no matter the trial I'm seeing, it belongs to you, Lord.
It's to our God.
This is just for the worshipers. Praise the name of Jesus. Why? Because he's my rock. He's my fortress. And he's my deliverer. In him will I trust. We moving, but praise the name. Praise the name. Come on, lift up a shout to him. Come on, lift up your worship to him. Hey, he deserves that and more. Come on, can you lift up your worship to him? Lift up your worship to him this morning. Come on, he inhabits this. He lives in this. Hey! This is for those who he's rewriting their stories. He's changing everything in your past. He's giving you hope. He's giving you freedom. He's giving you peace. He's rewriting our stories. You worship me. So let him turn it in your favor. Watch him work it for your. He's not done with what he started. He's not done until it's good. So let him turn it in your favor. Watch him work it for your good. He's not done with what he started. He's not done until it's good. So hello peace, hello joy, hello love, hello strength, hello hope, it's a new horizon. Hello peace, hello joy, hello love, hello strength, hello hope, it's a new horizon. So if you're ready for a breakthrough, just open up and just receive.
It's not.
this is not the end.
Yes, he is.
But he is. And because he is everlasting, he's everlasting. Fear is not your future. You may feel sick in your body right now, but sickness is not where you live. Sickness is not your home. Scripture says he's near to the broken heart. So heartbreak is not your home. Come on, you declare that. Hello, peace. Hello, joy. Hello. Hello, strength. Hello, hope. Smooth rise. Hello. Hello, peace.
Thank you for the new horizon. Listen, the prophet Isaiah, I just want to read this scripture to you just to get some context to this moment. In Isaiah, the 43rd chapter, 18th verse, Israel was going through a whole lot of things and was questioning whether God was for them. And they were, God, why did you bring us out here? But look at this message that the Lord gave to his people. It says, to remember ye not the former things.
Yes.
Neither consider the things of old. For behold, I will do
a new thing.
A new thing. Now shall it not spring forth? Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and the rivers in the desert. And I was riding up the highway up here, and God said, son, in order to embrace the new thing, they have to do what was in 18. You got to forget first.
Yes.
And so many times we don't have capacity to receive God's new because we're so busy holding on to what used to be. And we're so busy holding on to what mama did us and what our ex-husband did to us and to what our enemies are doing to us. God said, but if you can forget the former thing, that releases me to do a new thing. And so I want us to do an exercise of forgetting this morning. I know that society frowns upon people not having good memory, but you literally can make a decision. I'm going to forget my old status. I'm going to forget everything that happened to me. So I want you to right now to lift up your hand and say, God, right now, I forget the former things and the things of old so that I can embrace the new that you have for me. And say, so God, someone say, so God, right now, I thank you for making a way in the wilderness. I'm not asking you to deliver me from the wilderness. God, you said that you can make a way in the wilderness. Not only that, God, but I am asking you to make a river in my desert. Anybody feel like you're in the desert right now? Well, we serve a God who can make an oasis in your desert. He may not deliver you from it, but he will sustain you in it. He may not deliver you from the sickness just yet, but he will keep you in the midst of what you're going through. So therefore we can say, fear is not my future. Sickness is not my story. I will do a new thing. Somebody thank you for the new thing. We're not going to wait for the new year to embrace our new thing. We're not going to wait for a new season.
You are.
That is not the end.
That is not the end.
You are.
so, God, we come to you now. Lord, we renounce every negative word. We renounce every negative plot that the enemy has had over our lives. And we declare that fear is not our story. Sickness does no longer belongs to us. Heartbreak is no longer a place that we feel comfortable anymore. Lord, we know you are our hope. You are our refuge, God. And so, Lord, we take our hands off of our situations. Lord, knowing that we've just made a mess after mess after mess of it. Lord, knowing that you are the great provider. You are the great sustainer. All that we have ever needed, your hand has always provided. And so, Lord, we put our faith in the one who can fix it all today. We put our confidence in the one who can heal. We put our confidence in the one who can deliver. We put our confidence in the one who can set straight the things that are crooked in our lives, God. So, Lord, we declare, Lord, that we have faith in you. Lord, you said without faith, it is impossible to please you. So, Lord, we declare our faith and our confidence and our fidelity in your good work, God. So, Lord, we declare, Lord, that on this week, God, you're going to shift something. You're going to remove something. You're going to set something in order, God. Lord, it is your good pleasure to bless your children, God. So, Lord, we get in a posture to receive what you have for us right now, knowing that fear is no longer our future, but faith is, God. That sickness is no longer our story, but healing is. That poverty is no longer our legacy, God. But Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we live in abundance and we live in overflow right now, God. Lord, we bless the people of God. Lord, we come to hear what you have to say, God. Lord, we want you to walk the aisles of this room. Lord, we want you to heal. We want you to set free. We want you to deliver. We want you to uplift those that are heavy burdened, God. And Lord, we'll be careful in advance to give your name glory, to give your praise, Lord. Not for only what you've done, but what you're doing, God. We don't understand, Lord. Our ways are not like your ways. Our thoughts are not like your thoughts, God. But your resume is good with us. So, God, we say we trust you. We don't understand it, but we trust you. We don't know how it's going to work out, but we do know that you have never lost a case. We do know that you have never lost a battle. And so, God, we say, God, do your good work in the lives of your people today. Lord, we release you, Lord, to do your good work in your people's lives, God. And so, God, we love you. We bless you. And, Lord, on this rainy day, Lord, we didn't come to play games, God. We came to get something from you, God. So we declare by the time we leave this building, somebody's going to have an answer. Somebody's going to get just what they need to take just the next step of faith, God. Lord, bless our neighbor that's beside us, God. We don't know there are myriad of issues in this room, God. Would you bless our neighbor? Would you meet their need? Would you heal their body? Would you fix what's going on in their family? God, would you just bless our neighbor today? Lord, for we know when you bless our neighbor, God, you're in the neighborhood and it won't be long that you're going to come see about us, God. So, Lord, we sit in anticipation of what you're about to do. Lord, for everything that you do is good and it's for our good. God, we love you. We bless you. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray, amen and amen. Come on, somebody give God the best praise of the day. Come on. Come on, come on. Let him know you have confidence in him. Come on, come on. Tell somebody beside you, fear is no longer my future. Fear is no longer my future. I am in expectation of what God is about to do. Come on, tell somebody beside you. Come on, come on, brother Elmo. Tell them, kind of watch this spot. God's about to do something new. God's about to do something new with me.
He's rewriting your story.
Come on, declare.
Old things are passed away. Behold, I make all things new.
Put your hand together and just bless the Lord. Come on, don't just patty cake him. Come on, come on. Come on, give him real praise. Come on, give him real praise. Somebody open up your mouth a little bit. Come on, open your mouth just a little bit. Come on, cheer him. Say, God, you're about to do something that I have never even thought about. You're about to do something that I could not even fathom. You're about to do something that is about to blow my mind. You're about to do something. You're about to do exceedingly and abundantly above my anything I could ever think or even imagine. Hallelujah. Somebody say, do it, God. Hallelujah. seats and turn your attention to the screen. God bless you.
Hey, World Overcomers, the greatest show on earth is coming October 29th on a Saturday from 12 to 3. You don't want to miss it. It's for the whole community. We're going to have carnival games. We're going to have a ton of candy. We're going to have all kinds of inflatables, face painting, balloon artists. We're just going to have people on stilts. It's just going to be amazing. You don't want to miss it. It's for everyone. So don't forget, bring your friends and your families and just invite somebody to come. You don't want to miss it. The greatest show on earth, Harvest Fest, is coming. So don't forget, October 29th. 12 to 3 on a Saturday, right here at World Overcomers. We're going to see you there.
Some of us have gotten diagnoses attached to our names, but praise God, there's another side to that. What am I saying to you today? It don't end this way.
Some of you don't know that the only reason you are hidden now is because God is waiting for the right time to unwrap you so that he can shift the industry.
Paul already knows that trouble is on the way, because when you're a man of God, you can be in the midst of a very bad situation and still have insight from God that everything is going to be all right.
Hear me. We are quenching our thirst with the wrong things. And the word of God, his biblical word, is what I gotta quench my thirst with.
Because right now you are in a love affair with stuff that don't give you no fruit. You are in a love affair with things that don't bring you anything that can actually be productive for your future or for generational wealth. You are in love with stuff. You're infatuated with stuff that's attractive on the outside. It looks nice. It's cute. Oh yeah, it's so nice. But it can't bring you any fruit.
Listen, I have just a couple of announcements I want to draw your attention to. Somebody say, color of the summer. This is our end of summer celebration that we have for our youth. Are any parents out here glad that it's time for the babies to go on back? And they're eating up all your food all summer. You ready to send them back, ain't you? Well, we're going to have a celebration called Color of the Summer. It is going to be a festive time, but everybody's going to be looking like a rainbow by the time they're finished. And so we want you to come out, and even if you don't want to participate, just bring your children. It's a great time of fellowship and just celebration to the end of the summer. The only thing that we ask is that you don't wear a white t-shirt. Amen. We want to keep this a holy event. And see, people are going to be getting wet, and there's going to be a lot of color. And so we want to make sure that we keep it a holy event. Tell somebody, keep it holy. Keep it holy. No white t-shirts. Amen. Amen. Wear your favorite t-shirt of color of your choice. God bless you. Secondly, in this is the beginning of our fellowship. Somebody say fellowship. Fellowship. One of the ways that this big, huge church can feel small, can feel intimate, is that you get involved in fellowship. Amen. Amen. So we want in the lobby, our women's ministry as well as the men's ministry, they're going to have a table out in the lobby. They're going to have QR codes on the table that you can simply scan and you can join a fellowship group. It is the mass group of men. It is the mass group of women. But they also have small little cluster groups that you can get together in fellowship. It's not Bible study. It's not prayer group. It is simply men and women of God getting together and just sharing life together. Amen? So we want you to do that. In addition, next week, we are having new members class, okay? Now, I want to give a little clarity. There are a lot of people who signed up to be members. You are on the roll, but you have not been through class yet. Tell somebody, go to school. You got to go to class so we can plug you in so you can learn about the ministry. I'm not a part of anything that I don't know about. Amen. And so the class is a way where you can ask questions. You can learn what we're about. You can learn how you can contribute and how the benefits. There are benefits to membership. Amen. Amen. And you want to know what you're in, and you want to know the benefits of what you're involved with. So we want you to do that. on next week. Amen. But lastly, the last participating thing that we can do today before the word come, and is anybody ready for the word of God to come? Amen. Come on, make a little bit more noise for the word. Amen. Before we do that, amen, we're going to obey the word through giving. Amen. Amen. You can't be a fan of the word and not obey the word. Amen. The word of God says that when we come into his house, we should come with a gift. Amen. Back in the olden days, they used to bring their livestock and they used to bring their grain and all that stuff. Now, I don't know if anybody's a farmer, but the church can't use your corn this week. But we can use, we can use your produce now, your modern day produce, which is the money that God blesses you with. Amen. So that we, all the schools that we're about to bless with all those book bags and stuff to bus, we are able to do that because of your faithful giving. So we want you to continue in that vein. There are a plethora of ways to which you can give, and we want to invite those that are online. I know it was a rainy day and some people may have stayed home, but you can still participate in the same level of worship that we are in here in this room. So we want you to give, we want you to sow, we want you to tithe, and we want you to give your best gift to Victory Park as God is doing a new thing. Somebody say a new thing. God is doing a new thing in the lives of God's people. Amen. If you need an envelope, you would raise your hand and one of our brothers in blue will get to you very quickly. Amen. Amen. Thank y'all so much for your dedication to come out in the rain. I know you. It was slow getting up. You had to rock a couple of times, but thank you. I believe that God is going to bless your faithfulness for coming to God's house today. All right, let's lift that device or that envelope, whatever you have in the atmosphere. Let's pray to the Lord. Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to give and to sow. God, it's a privilege to give unto your kingdom, God, because you own it all. So, Lord, thank you, Lord, for entrusting us with the wealth and the riches that you have given us, knowing, God, that it all belongs to you. So, Lord, we just want to give you a portion back of what you've blessed us with. Lord, we're not trying to pay you for what you do, Lord, because that is impossible for the value that you bring to our lives. But God, we are being obedient to your word and your scripture, Lord, knowing that when it leaves our hands, Lord, it goes into our future, God. So we thank you, Lord, that as we release what's in our hands, God, you're releasing joy and peace and prosperity. Lord, we thank you that somebody gets a promotion on this week. Lord, we pray that somebody, God, gets a call saying that the loan has gone through. Lord, we pray that something gets corrected as a result that we can tie to the obedience that we exhibited on today. God, we love you, we bless you, and we trust you with our substance. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you as you give.
See, yeah. No one else can. The fight to trust you, what you will do will exceed anything we've dreamed.
For you are the God of great,
and you are the God.
You are the God
of bigger.
Of big.
Yes, you are the God.
Yes, you are the God of more.
Exceeding,
exceeding.
things that you
we are believing bigger.
Maybe that's you.
We are trusting you for so much more. We know you will perform.
We are expecting
greater.
We are believing.
That's it. We are trusting you.
We are.
Yes, we are.
For so much more.
We know you will perform.
We are expecting greater.
We are trusting you.
Yes, we are.
For so much more.
We know you will perform.
Say it's already done. Can your faith speak louder than your fears? For just a minute, can you take just a moment on a Sunday morning around the world? Can your faith speak louder? Can your faith say it's already done? Can your faith say I'm already healed? Can your faith say God, what you promise you will perform? You're worthy, God, you're worthy, you're worthy. Hallelujah. You may be seated. In the name of the Lord, we have babies to be dedicated. And in this Holy Ghost moment, let's dedicate these babies while our faith is talking. Hallelujah. Let's dedicate these children. And so will the parents and godparents and grandparents and whoever you got with you, your little clan of these children, Kylie Flanagan, Raylan Wills, Olivian Butler, and Chrisette Kinch, come on down. And we are going to dedicate these babies to the Lord. Kylie and Raylan and Olivian and Chrisette. And we are going to dedicate these children. And thank God for family. Thank God for family. Thank God for family. No, I said thank God for family. Somebody thank God for the Power family. Thank God for love. Thank God. Praise the Lord. All right. Welcome, 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 welcome. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Okay, if the elder or the deacon can hold the baby, if they'll let them, and that would be great. Praise the Lord. Y'all praise God for family one more time. We're excited that you're with us this morning. We call this baby dedication, and really some people think of it as a christening, although you know there's really no place in the Bible where babies are baptized. So we don't really baptize babies because we believe that baptism is an outward sign of an inward work. But what we do with children is, like Jesus, he took children into his arms and he blessed them. He said, suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. And this is such a powerful thing. We just finished singing about what our faith says. Having children takes faith. Raising babies takes faith. Putting them in the world takes faith. It is a continuation of your faith for you to believe that what God has done in your life, it will continue, that it's not going to just end with you, but that God is blessing you not just for you, but for you to pass stuff on to the next generation. Just having babies is a faith act. And what we really are doing is just reminding ourselves that these children belong to God. And we're saying it's a dedication, and we're dedicating them to the Lord. But really what we're doing is we're remembering that we are stewards of all of this stuff. We're stewards of these little lives. These little children belong to God. And so we're stewards of their lives, and we're determined to raise them in the fear of God and to teach them. And this prayer we're about to pray, as powerful as it is, as great as it is, nothing. If you want your child to act right, you got to act right. If you want your child to live right, you got to live right. Want your child to talk right, you got to talk right. Want your child to clean right, you might want to clean right. Want your child to read, might be a good idea for them to catch you reading. Want your child to worship God, might be a good idea for them to catch you worshiping the Lord and blessing His name. And so our children ultimately are a reflection of us. And how they are is how we are. And so we pray for them and bless them. But then we also have to realize that the blessing also comes through us. And our role in their lives and us talking to them and loving them and praying for them. And that's a powerful thing. And so we're going to pray for these children right now. And so I want all of the moms to stand. If you're in the room with us this morning and you're somebody's mother, can you just stand? Praise God for all the mothers that are with us this morning. And praise God for all of the moms that are with us this morning. And let's pray. Y'all come real close to the elder. Come close to the deacon that's there with it close. And let's pray for these children. Lord, we want to thank you that this moment is bathed in prayer. Thank you that this room is bathed in prayer. Thank you that we have decided to make this a house of prayer. Lord, we've decided to make this a place where we can call on your name. Because you said in your word, if your people who are called by your name will humble ourselves and pray and seek your face and turn from our own wicked ways, that you would hear from heaven, you would forgive our sin, and you would heal our land. God, we're asking you to heal our land. God, we're asking you to heal our people. God, we're asking you to unite us together in power. God, we're asking you right now to strengthen these families, these babies, God. These mamas decided to have them, but you decided to send them, and thank you for the mission that you sent them on. Thank you that they have a purpose. Thank you that there's no accidents. Thank you that all things work together for the good of us who love you and are called according to your purpose. And so, God, we trust you. We throw our faith at the situation. We throw our faith. Our faith says, it's already done. We throw our faith at every baby. We throw our faith at these babies. We throw our faith at every baby that's listening around the world. We throw our faith at all the babies of all the mamas that are standing. And God, we're believing that no weapon formed against our seed shall be able to prosper. No sickness, it won't prosper. No disease, it won't prosper. No curse, it will not prosper. No plan of the enemy, it shall not prosper. We're believing that they will be what you sent them here to be. That your anointing will rest on these babies. From the crown of the head to the soles of their little feet. God, from the crown of our children's head to the soles of their feet. God, we pray that this life we live, this 80, 90 years we live, won't just be for us, but that we might leave something to our children's children's children, that God will have faith for something greater than just what we have and what we can experience in our lifetime. And we pray that our children will be prepared to receive what we leave them, and that we will walk by faith and not by sight. Have your way in us. Kingdom of God, come in us. Will of God be done in us. In Jesus' name we pray. We all said together, amen. Praise the Lord. If you agree with that prayer this morning, where's Kylie? Kylie? I'm saying her name right? Kylie? Okay. Oh, wait. Kylie. Wait. Oh. Y'all praise God for Kylie. Can y'all praise God for Kylie? Praise God. Pretty girl. She look a little sleepy, which is Jesus. This is Raylan. See how it says R-E-A? Somebody told me Rylan. That's my bad. And bad of the people that told me, oh my Lord, look at this girl in her eyes. Y'all praise God for Rylan. Woo, heartbreaker. I almost want to be like in them contacts. This little girl, woo! Hey, girly girl. Welcome to World Overcomers. Welcome to World Overcomers. Get me away from that crazy man. Olivian. Oh, gosh. Y'all praise God for Olivian. Girly girl. Everybody's eyes are just like looking. Check it out. Look. It's church. Welcome to church. Look at your bow. Look at your shoes, girl. All right. And last but not least, Chrisette. Oh, y'all praise God for Chrisette. You upset? Sorry. Pretty girl. Y'all praise God for them. God bless y'all. Bless y'all. Bless you. Thanks so much for coming. Y'all going back to your seats unless y'all have a word for everybody? No. Praise God. Thanks for being here. Thanks for coming to church. Thanks for family and grandparents and whoever traveled and then came to church in the rain. Hallelujah. Welcome. We want to welcome all of you, name by name, person by person, to World Overcomers Christian Church. For all of you that made it to be in the room, and for all of you that are watching around the world, World Overcomers is a young church, and God has given us this vision, balance, victory for the God-designed life. And what that simply means is that we believe that our lives will count for God. If you hear me say that all the time, and hear me say it over and over ad nauseum, sorry, but I want my life to count for God, and I want your life to count for God. They used to say that to us when I was young. Let your life count for God. Let your life matter for more than just stuff and things and people and stuff that ultimately will not satisfy. Let your life count for God. Not just your Sunday, but let your life count for God. That my living will not be in vain, and that people will be affected by my life, because my life speaks louder than my mouth, and I want my life to be a reflection of His glory, and I want to walk according to His purpose, not just according to people, not just according to things, not just according to stuff, but for my life to be about something greater than just what I can hold in my hand, and that I realize that the chase for pleasure will leave me empty. What really fills me is a chase for purpose. And for me to ask God, what is the purpose for my life? What is on your heart? What do you want me to do? I don't want to just do what I want to do. I want to hear a word. word from you. I want you to tell me what you have sent me here to do. I want to know why I'm here and what is my assignment. It's got to be for more than coffee. It's got to be for more than shoes. It's got to be more for more than nice hair. It's got to be more for more than just a nice person on my shoulder. There's got to be a reason why you have sent me here. My mama decided to have me, but God sent me on a mission, and I'm not an accident, and I want a relationship with my maker, and I want God to tell me why I'm here, and I want to hear him say, well done, when I see his face. I want to have more than just money in my bank account. I want to have peace in my heart and peace in my soul. I want my soul to be blessed. My soul to be anchored in the Lord. And I've come to the realization in my 50 years on the planet that stuff don't make you happy. I need a witness in the building. All the cars you want, all the house you want, all the money you want, it won't make you happy. You can have all of the stuff you want, all the golds you want, all the Jordans you want. It won't make you happy if your soul is not right. I want my life to count for God. I want my life to count for him. God knows how we are formed. I was reading an article that was talking about the world today and how every hit of pleasure leaves a deficit afterwards. Whenever you go after something pleasurable, you get that hit of dopamine, whatever it may be. Your phone, whatever you eat, you watch, you binge the show, you eat a piece of cake, whatever it is, when the pleasure hits you, immediately afterwards, there is a dip in you chemically. That's why it's not enough to eat one cookie, you gotta eat two. You gotta eat a bag. It's not enough to eat one chip, you got to eat the bag. One slice of pizza just won't do. The ordinary just won't do. It's not enough to get a slice, I need a whole pizza. I need to eat until I'm stuffed. It's not enough to watch one episode of Ozark, I gotta watch the next one, and I gotta watch the next one, and wow, what an amazing episode of House. And I'm so glad I don't have that disease. And now, I got to watch another one, because the minute you put your phone down, you go on there, somebody hearted your picture, and you got a bump in you like, oh, somebody care about me. And the minute that's gone, it mentally, chemically, there is a deficit. So the chase for pleasure is a chase for a high that you will, that never ends. Oh, I wish I knew. I wish somebody knew what I was talking about. That's what happens with drug addicts, is that they get that first hit and there's a high they receive, and then they chasing that high till their money is gone. I know y'all don't know nothing about that, but there's this stuff called drugs that if you take a hit of it, it gives you a high. And even if you've never had drugs, you've had drugs, because sugar is a drug. Oh, yes, it is. I need me some sugar. It's white lines. My white lines is sugar. I can't get no amens in this room. But there's something about a Reese's peanut butter cup that fills me with joy. There's something about a piece of cake that is, there's an anointing on the cobbler. And the problem is that once you finish that, there's a deficit. So if you're just chasing pleasure, you will constantly be chasing pleasure. The way to flip it is to chase pain. I got quiet. Chase pain. Go run till your leg hurts. When you're done running, what has happened is during the run, you were lowering your pleasure. But when you got done, then endorphins hit you and raise you to a pleasurable place. You can't find pleasure chasing pleasure. You find pleasure chasing purpose. Can I get a witness in the building? There is no greater joy bringer than purpose. And I want to fulfill the purpose of God. I want to walk by faith and not by sight. And we're excited that you're with us in the room. If you're a first-time visitor with us online, just let us know. In the room, in the main lobby, there's a connection point, and we want to share something with you. And on behalf of myself, Pastor Andy, and all of the leaders here at World Overcomers, all of the elders and deacons and staff, and all of us, even if we're not here, we want to welcome you to our church and to this moment. We trust you sense the presence of God. I trust you're ready to hear a word from the Lord. I do have a word for you. I've got 40 minutes. Let's look at the word. How many have a Bible or an iPad or something? Throw your Bible over your head, wave something at me. Okay, jump on your feet with me really quickly. Let's look at the word of God together. I'm going to share something with you, let you go. Genesis chapter number 12. We started looking at this last Sunday. And we're going to pick right up from it from where we were last Sunday, Genesis 12, Hebrews 11. We're going to look at a passage in Galatians that's on the screens if you're not prepared. It's on the screens if you're not prepared. Let's jump into it. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 says, the Lord said to Abraham, I want you to go from your country, from your people, your father's household. I want you to go to the land that I'm going to show you, and I'm going to make you into a great nation. I'm going to bless you, and I'll make your name great. You'll be a blessing. I'm going to bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I'm going to curse, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. So Abraham left as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8, just picks the story back up. Says, actually, this happened by faith. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went. Even though he really did not know where he was going, by faith he made his home in the promised land. Like a stranger in a foreign country, he lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 6. Another familiar passage of scripture. Galatians 3, 6 says, so also Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Scriptures foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. Verse 13 says, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. Verse 14, he redeemed us in order that the blessings of Abraham, he redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham, see, he redeemed us for a purpose. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might actually come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Title of my message this morning is Favor in Your DNA. Favor in Your DNA. Bow your head, let me pray for now. Lord, I pray that you'll speak, Lord, just now. Some wonderful truth that you'd have for us to see. God, I pray in these next 30, 40 minutes or so, Lord, we have pressed our way through the rain into this building here in North Carolina, and then people are watching from their homes, literally around the world. And so, God, we pray in this room and in every room that's watching that you would, at this moment, have your way. May this be a Spirit-led moment. May this be a Spirit-filled moment. May this be more than just a flesh moment. May this be a Christ moment. My gift is small. It is my all. Accept it, Lord, I pray. Let self be slain. Let Jesus reign in this moment. Reign, Jesus, reign. And we'll praise you for what you do, what you say. God, you're so worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. We all said together. We all said together. Amen. You may be seated. In the name of the Lord. Favor in your DNA. If I could draw your attention to Galatians chapter 3, verse 13 and 14, I hope that these passages are familiar to you. I trust and hope and pray and believe. And if not, that's all right. I'm going to make it familiar to you right now that Galatians 3, 13 and 14 are passages that you've heard before and that you're familiar with them because they're powerful. Galatians 3, 13 says Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. My opening concept to communicate to you this morning, that's good news, is the curse is broken. Tell somebody the curse is broken. The curse is broken. At your house, tell somebody the curse is broken. Touch that seat next to you and tell them the curse is broken. The curse is broken. I don't know if there's almost any better news I can give you than the idea that the curse is broken. Even the idea of generational curses, they're broken. I know there's been a whole lot of talk and books written on generational curses, but thanks be to God that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. I know that many of us who were raised holiness were taught that there is a curse connected to disobedience, and a curse connected to doing wrong, and a curse connected to unrighteousness. And absolutely, just by the scriptures, there is a curse connected to stuff that's not right. But thanks be to God that Galatians 3:13 says that Christ has actually redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. Right off from the start, I just want to begin just by trying to clarify. I don't want to spend too much time on it because I have a lot to say this morning. But let me just say it to you in the room and everyone around the world. The curse is broken. The curse is broken. Now, I know that there's a part of our human desire that in our drive to make sense of chaotic stuff, we want to make it about a curse. You go outside, you look up in the sky, you see the cloud. Your brain wants to make sense of the thing that it can't make sense of. So it looks at a cloud and says, oh, that looks like a truck, or oh, that looks like a dog, oh, that looks like a horse, because your brain is always trying to take chaotic abstract pictures and make some sense of it. Same is true in life. Something about our minds that wants to make sense of things that often are inexplicable. And what we did in the church world is we just got off easy. Instead of saying, I don't know why, we just decided to label it curse and connected it to sin and connected it to wrongdoing, and we ignored Galatians chapter 3, which is a truth that says that the curse is broken. I was talking to a young man who's in the church and faithful and serves and awesome, great guy. And him and I were having a conversation. He wanted to ask me a question. I said, okay, what's the question? And he told me, so funny, on baby dedication, him and his wife trying to have a child. And so his wife conceived and they were excited about it. And in his joy to just celebrate it, he went out and hung out with some friends and he was just having a good time with them and just celebrating the fact that his wife had conceived a child. And then, see, you know, something got lit and something started getting passing on the left hand side and puff puff give, and he somehow found himself in a rotation. I know y'all don't know even what I'm talking about, but somehow he found himself in a rotation and the puff to give and the puff to give and the puff to give. And normally, because he's all in saved in church and everything, he would just pass it on along because he's with them, but he's trying not. But on this particular moment, he was happy, and when it passed to him in a rotation, he puffed and gave it to the next person. And about a week later, his wife lost the baby. So his question to me is, did she lose the baby because he puffed and gived? And I said, son, wait a minute. I'm sorry that your wife lost the baby, and we can't explain stuff like that. We can't explain how people who should have children can't have them. Good God. We can't explain how folk are trying to have a child and having a hard time having one. And folk who are trying not to have one got one right now. Can't get no amens in here. Stuff like that that we can't explain. And instead of just saying, I don't know why that happened. No, we raise people in a condemnation, fear-based, wrong-based, this is why. And so he has come to the conclusion that Puff Puff Given killed his unborn child. It is a lie. I'm gonna make everybody clap for it. It's a lie. If you've been taught that, let me correct that for you. If perfection is required for your blessing, if Puff Puffin killed babies, then there's a whole lot of us in here wouldn't even be here. I need an amen on that. I'm so sorry. I wish it was that simple. I said, the Bible says that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. He redeemed us so that he redeemed us from the curse. So if there was a curse, I suppose, connected to that, then I believe me, that ain't what caused it. Because you've been redeemed from the curse. I'm just feeling the Holy Ghost in this moment. I hear, because this is a part of the reason, beloved, why the younger generations and young folk, they want nothing to do with the church, because we have a math that just doesn't make sense, that's not explainable. Everything can't be pointed to a cause. Christ has redeemed us. I said, son, Christ has redeemed you. He said, all right, I could tell that he understood redemption, but he didn't really understand redemption. And there's a story that I've never told that I'm going to tell now. I wish I had told him this story, but I didn't tell him this story. Let me tell you all this story real quick, and then I'm going to move on and say what else the Lord would have me to say. I told him when I was a young man, probably about 10, maybe 9 or 10 years old, I was young. I was with some of my friends, and we were in a store, and they were getting stuff, and I didn't have any money to get anything, and I was hungry, and I liked this thing called an iced honey bun. I don't know if you've ever had an iced honey bun. I'm not talking about a honey bun. I'm talking about an iced honey bun. You understand? It's got this icing on it that's just anointed. And so I was 10 and I was hungry. I didn't have any money and my friends was getting stuff, and I took an iced honey bun, slipped it in my pocket, and basically stole an iced honey bun, put it in my pocket, and then when they were acted like I bought it, I stole it. We're outside, everybody's eating, and we're eating a honey bun. That was on a Saturday. On Sunday, I went to church. Oh Lord. And it just so happened that the message was on stealing. And then I started to feel all kinds of guilty. And somebody told a story about how they stole something and they returned it, and they took it back. And I went to the altar so I wouldn't bust head wide open. But the problem was that the honey bun was already eaten and digested and probably was flushed. And I just did not know what to do. And I was upset and I was down and I was sad and I felt like I'm going to hell. And I was scared, and I was scared to go to sleep, and I wasn't sleeping that well. And I was all convicted and feeling all terrible. And my dad came to me on like Tuesday and said, what is wrong with you? You've been upset these last couple days. And I just said to him, you know, Dad, I was with my friends and I wanted a honey bun, and I stole one and I ate it, and I heard the story about returning it, but I can't return it, and I ate it, and now God's going to be mad at me and I'm not going to get my blessings, and I can't sleep because I ate this honey bun. And my dad said, I hear you, son. All right, tell you what, let's get in the car. We got in the car. He said, where is the store? We drove down to the store. When we drove to the store, we got out the car and we went inside. He said, stand there. I stood there. He went up to the man and said, my son took a honey bun from you, and what I'm going to do is pay for it. So he gave the man the money for the honey bun and then turned to me and said, see, your guilt is gone because stolen, it is now purchased. I'm sorry, I thought I was gonna get a whole lot better response than that. Because there is stuff that you have done that you cannot take back. I need a witness in here. There is stuff that you have done that if God is counting faults up in here, you are doomed. But Christ went into the store and paid for your honey bun, and now Christ has redeemed you from whatever curse. Somebody praise God. You are redeemed from the curse. He paid the price with his blood. You ain't got to worry about what you did. You ain't got to worry about what happened when you were 18. You ain't got to worry about what you did when you were 17. You ain't got to worry about what you did 2 years ago. It's all right. Christ has redeemed you from the curse. Praise God because you're redeemed. Come on, praise God because you're redeemed. If you're home, praise God, you're redeemed. Now, verse 14, because let me get into what the Lord wants me to say. He wants me to say that, but let me tell you this. Verse 14, he says, he redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. He redeemed us, just like the reason why my father redeemed me. He didn't redeem me because it was just so wrong to eat the honey bun and to take a honey bun. It was 50 cents. It was 25 cents. Back then when I was 10, it was 25 cents. This is back when stuff didn't cost $1 million. This is back when you could go to the penny candy store. Let me. So he didn't just do that just because it was so wrong to steal a honey bun. He did that because he's my father. I am his son, and he needs me to get over what I have done because there's a blessing that he has for me. And if I don't get over my faults, I won't ever be able to believe that the blessing really belongs to me. So Christ redeemed you in order that the blessing of Abraham may be something that you actually believe you can have. Because the thing about guilt and condemnation and feeling bad about the mistakes you made and who you hurt and what you did, and you had this and you did this and this one happened and you got this thing and you got that done, is that it has a way of blocking you from believing that God can do great for you. You'll be right on the verge of believing God for something great. And then the enemy will remind you of something that you did when you were 21. Or remind you of something you did when you were 18. Or reminded you of something you did when you was 32. Or remind you of something. And even though you ask God to forgive you, and the Bible says that he casts your sin into a sea of forgetfulness and remembers them no more. But the problem is that we still remember. And one of the things that I try to do, can I encourage you this morning? I'm going to move on. Can I encourage you not to remind God about stuff he done forgot? We're looking at God telling him he can't bless us. And the Lord is saying, well, what is it that I can't bless you? What is it that's stopping you? And we're remembering something that he has forgotten. And so a part of the reason why he said, well, I paid the price and you're redeemed, is he redeemed us because we have an inheritance. Well, Galatians 3:7 says, understand that those who have faith, children of Abraham, Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. So if you have faith in here, I have faith, you have faith, you are the seed of Abraham. Abraham's inheritance belongs to you by faith. When God said to Abraham, I'm gonna bless everybody through you, what he meant was, I'm gonna make you the father of faith, meaning that after this, anybody who has faith will be able to claim inheritance and connection to you, Abraham. So, a part of the reason why he redeemed us is he redeemed us so that we would not disqualify our own selves by our guilt, by our fear, by our condemnation from the inheritance that we have from Abraham. Now, I'm pretty sure Abraham is a figure that you are familiar with. I've been doing this series on Sunday school, but in case you have been misinformed, let me just let you know, Abraham is somebody that you want his inheritance. I don't know if you've ever sat around wishing and hoping and praying that you will find out that somehow you are related to somebody that's really got something. Well, you have found out this morning. We have done a DNA test on you. We took you on the Maury Povich show, and we are telling you that Abraham is your father. Abraham got babies all over the place. Abraham got so many children. He don't know what to do. Abraham got babies all over the world because all you have to do is to decide, I believe God. All you have to do is decide, I have faith in God. All you have to do is say, you know what? God can do anything but fail. All you have to do is say, you know what? Let's pray about that, because I believe that if I pray, God hears me. And I believe if I say in Jesus' name, something will take place. You know what? Let's go down to church. You know what? Let's turn the phone on, turn the movie room on, and let's look at that crazy guy who's always talking about faith, and let's believe God. And you know what? God will credit it to us as righteousness. Meaning that God likes faith so much that it's okay if you ain't perfect. And I'm so glad all the imperfect people like me in church, that all the imperfect people like me are glad about that, because Christ the Lord sees faith and does an exchange of faith for righteousness. He counts it as righteousness. So that even if you mess up, even if you blow it, the Lord will be like, yeah, but that faith, I like that faith though. I still want to be with you though. Even though you have done wrong, and even though you haven't always said the right stuff, and even though you ain't always been at the right places, and even though you ain't always done all the right things. But you know what though? There's something about your faith. There's something about you believing in me that I like. I like you, and I'm going to give you righteousness for faith. So, if you are a believer in here, if you believe God, then if you have faith, then you have access to Abraham's inheritance. You are Abraham's seed. Now, last Sunday I said, and I'm going to say it again, Abraham wasn't a preacher. Abraham wasn't a prophet. Abraham wasn't some anointed lead. Abraham wasn't a Levite. Abraham was a businessman. Abraham was somebody that did business. One of the mistakes that we've made in the church is everybody is just trying to jam up in the pulpit, because we have a tendency to only glorify pulpit anointing. And we don't take the time to acknowledge that if you do well in business, that means that there is a favor on you to do well in business. If you do well in a field, there must be favor on you to do well in that field, in that area. It's not just anointing for church. Matter of fact, just to prove the point, God made the guy that was the father of faith not be Elijah. Not be Isaiah, not be one of the prophets. God made the guy that was the father of faith to be a guy that was about business. Just so that no one will get it twisted and think that God is only about the clergy. So Abraham's legacy is not just faith, but it's faith for business. And we started to talk about that. It's an inheritance. Now, there's two ways to see the word inheritance. And this may sound simple to you, but I want to explain it really quickly so we're all on the same page. Two ways to see an inheritance. The first way to see an inheritance is to inherit things. Inherit things. Things. This past week, I found out, counted a couple of weeks ago, that my great-grandfather on my mom's side, the Winstons, my great-grandfather on my mother's side owned some land in Virginia that I didn't know about. So I drove down to Virginia and hacked through into this land and found this 11 acres that my great-grandfather purchased in 1902. How he bought this land in 1902, 40 years after the Emancipation Proclamation. We're talking about the son or grandson of slaves at best was able to purchase land in 1902. That means that this land has been in my family for 120 years and I did not know about it. And he bought the land for hunting. And he was a hunter. And his son, my grandfather, was a hunter. And his son, my uncle, was not a hunter. The hunting ability skipped the generation. And my mama has 8 children, and there's only one dude in the whole family who moved to North Carolina and got trucks and chainsaws and guns and machetes and four-wheelers and who is a hunter. And I didn't even realize that God brought me here to be with you country people and hang out with you, Garland, and your country self for you to be my hunting pastor, because he was trying to get me some abilities for an inheritance that I had. Oh my God, that I didn't even know I had. And everybody else in the family don't even care about the land, but the land is valuable to me because the land is really just good for hunting, and I'm the only one that's the hunter. You know what I'm believing, God? That there's an inheritance for you that is so specifically made for you, and the process that you've been through is making you ready for what God has for you. Can I get a witness in here? I preached a message, I don't know, a year ago or so, called Paternity, Patriarchy, and Property. And I got some flack for it. I actually got some flack for it because the word patriarchy is a kind of word and people feel it's misogynistic. And I hear that, but you know what? You really only feel that way if didn't nobody ever leave you nothing. Only people who really feel that way are haters who ain't nobody never left them nothing. But when you walk through land worth money that you could not afford, that your great-grandfather paid $50 for, you are excited about the fact that there was some paternity and some patriarchy and it turned into property, because paternity and patriarchy without property is a problem. You will put up with your mama way better if she got something to leave you. Wish I had a witness in the building. For all of you that don't talk to your mama no more and don't talk to your daddy no more, it's because he's broke. But if he had an inheritance for you, you would get over your feelings and you would figure out a way to still go to the cookout. Can't get cut out the will. It's not just about being popular, it's about having property. I know you think I'm just so amazing, I'm just so wonderful. Maybe you don't. And I'm just this amazing father. I'm a pretty good father, but I got my sons in here. They'll tell you some stories about me that aren't necessarily so great. Well, I just had a great conversation with my sons, and I told them, I'm so glad we're doing so well. They're doing so well. And we just kind of hugged and game and made up, and I apologized for them to cuss for cussing them out, and they apologized to me for making me cuss them out, and we're just so happy together and just so wonderful, and it's all just so good. I realized in that moment, my boys are smart because not only are they ready to make up with me just because I'm their father, but you know what? I'm trying to leave an inheritance for my children's children's children. And there's forgiveness when there's an inheritance. Oh, I wish I had a witness in the building. There is a forgiveness when there's something in it for you. Now, when it comes to Abraham, beloved, we have an inheritance from Abraham, but we can't really inherit his things. I found out I've got this land that my great-great-grandfather purchased that now I can inherit it. I went down there and showed my license and the deed and went down to the thing, and they gave me a picture of the thing, and I hacked my way in there and found the land, and it's mine by inheritance. And so I have something I didn't purchase. I had something I did not buy. It's a great blessing. But when it comes to Abraham, you can't inherit his stuff. Y'all, if you live here, you live in North Carolina. If you're watching, you live in Ghana. You live in Australia. You live in New York. You live in Boston. You live wherever you live. You're not in Israel. So you can't make a claim on his land. It's not his things that you get to inherit. But that's okay, because the second thing that has to do with inheritance that we are way more familiar with is you inherit traits. You inherit traits, qualities. You look in the mirror and you see your mama. You look in the mirror and you see your daddy. Can only be but so mad at him because you're looking at his face every day. You might as well forgive him so you can forgive yourself because you look just like him. You inherit qualities, you inherit traits from your people. I did the ancestry.com thing. I don't know if you've done that, but I sent away for the kit. They sent it to me, and you spit in these tubes or whatever, and you send it off. Now, I had heard that my family was Native Americans. That's what I had heard, and that the reason why I look like this and all of that was because it was all this Native American and all of this Indian in my blood and Blackfeet tribe and this tribe and that tribe. And so that was a part of the reason why I sent away for the kit, because I was thinking to myself, maybe there's some Indian down in here, and I can get me one of these casinos. Matter of fact, I might put one on Victory Park. Anyway. And so that's part of the reason why I did the Ancestry.com, because I just heard up and down that it was all this Indian in here. So I thought, woo, man, I'm the Akawakamaka tribe, and I want to figure out what their tribe can get. You ain't got to say amen, but it's okay. It's me. And so I was thinking, ooh, maybe I'll put we'll put a casino over there, and y'all can see the AAU games and bet on them. So anyway, I thought to myself, that's what I can find out. So I did the thing, spit in the cup, sent it off, got my ancestry stuff, came back to me. Oh, I couldn't wait to open up the paper. I found out that I was 45% what I was the most. 45%. You ready? Nigerian. I mean, I had my royal headdress ready. I was ready to be all this Indian and found out I was 45% Nigerian. Forgive me, all of my Ghanaian who wanted me to be Ghanaian so bad. I'm 45% Nigerian. Some of you, that explains it. That's why you want the biggest stuff, because them Nigerians are this, and them Nigerians are that. That's exactly right. I'm 45% Nigerian, and that's why I want the biggest, baddest, most bubbly stuff. If there's a trait that has to do with blessing, if there's a trait that has to do with more, if there's a trait that has to do with greater, yes, I want that. Tell me that, because I want that trait. I know many of you are thinking, 45% Nigerian? Well, Pastor Andy, where all this light skin come from and all this curly hair? And this is my hair. This is not a kit. This is just natural juices and berries. And so I know you're wondering where all that come from. I'll tell you. Because the next greatest part of me was 40%, and I'm 40% Anglo-Saxon, England and Ireland. Hi, brother. Hey, Uncle Paul. Here I am, Elder Clark, swearing up and down. I'm all kinds of all, and find out that me and Jesse are closer than I thought we were. Both married these black women, bro. I'm with you. So, there's some stuff in me from the Nigerians, and I don't know how you feel about white people, and I know how I feel about them, but I can only be but so mad at white people since there's 40% of it right in me. And maybe I'm mad at myself, John. What I'm saying to you is there are traits that come from your ancestry. Powers, powers, powers. When I look at Abraham, I see powers. I see five of them. And I took a whole long time to get here, and I got 7 minutes left. But it's good. I'm sorry. I like this sermon, and I'm the one that preaches to me, so this is good. So powers, five powers that I see in Abraham. Since I can't inherit any of his stuff, I might as well inherit his traits. And I might as well say, well, this trait's in Abraham, and since I can't get his land, I'll inherit this trait. I see these five traits when I look at his story. I gave them to you last week. I'll give them to you again. The first trait, number one, is movement. The power of movement. And it's not just the power of movement, beloved. It's the power to move from increase to decrease to increase. Hear me. It's a key to success. Part of the reason why some people are not successful and why some people don't really have money and they can't be successful in business and they can't make a lot of money is because if they're making 100, they can't step down and make 60 with the possibility of making 250. They build a life based on the 100, and if an opportunity comes for them to decrease and maybe do something that's lower for a period of time with the potential possibility of going through a process to get higher, they can't do that. Talk to him, man. They get to that level and then they can't go down. They get stuck there. They climb a mountain. When you get to the top of that mountain, you see mountains that you did not see. You think $100,000 is a lot of money till you get it. I need a witness in here. You can remember when you made 30 and you were like, if I just make $60,000, I'll be so happy. You got $60,000 and that money was gone. You realize $60,000 ain't no money, and you thought, if I could just give me $120,000. And as soon as you got that $120,000, you wondered, where you wondered, how did you live on 30 when you can't make it on 120? I need a witness in here. And so you climb a mountain. Most people climb a mountain. And when they get to the top of that mountain, they see other mountains that are higher. But the problem is, you can't stop. You can't step from the top of one mountain to the top of another mountain. You're going to have to go down the mountain you're on. You may have to walk through a valley for a little bit. Let me just speak to everybody who may find themselves in a valley right now. Just because you're in a valley don't mean you ain't on your way up. Just because I'm in the valley right now don't mean that I wasn't at a high place before. I was at a high place before, but I came down to go higher. I actually had the faith and the courage to move from a place that was good. Ur of the Chaldees, that was city. That was courtyards. That was houses. Abraham left good living to go live in a tent. He left a place that didn't belong to him so that he'd rather have less and it be his than have more that belongs to somebody else. I'm going to speak that right now over every one of us in the name of Jesus. It would be better for you to have 4,000 square feet of a raggedy house that you own than 2,000 square feet of a house that you rent. No, I'm going to say that one more time. For you and me and all this other generation to just want to live in all these little high-rises. Well, they got tennis courts. Well, they have washing machines. Well, they have a workout space. And yeah, but how much are you paying for that 1,200 square feet of space? $1,800. So you're paying $1,800 for 1,200 square feet of space. It would be better for you, sweetheart, to take your $1,800 and go get you 3,000 square feet a house somewhere and fix it up. Don't be so moved by the perfection that you don't realize it'd be better to be in a tent with your inheritance than be in renting. This is a word right here. This is a word, son. This is a word we all need to hear because especially us, especially black folk, especially us, there's something about us. We like things. And if it's shiny, we get happy. We want to live high. We want everybody to know we got money. We're surrounded by millionaires that don't look like they got money, but we got to shine. And it's not even really our fault because we were denied land. We were denied access to stuff. And so the stuff we could get, that's why that dude cares about his car so much and living in an apartment. It ain't because he don't want a house. It's because the system was against him to get a house. And so he did really well with his car. But I would contend that a man who washes his car every week will cut his grass every week. If the system is fair enough, let me move on because I done left from preaching and gone down into meddling. My point is that Abraham had the courage to move from something high to something less. I wonder if I have a witness in the room that can wave and say, Pastor Andy, I know exactly what that feels like. I have been there. Sometimes I did it by choice. Sometimes they made me do it. They laid me off. They fired me. They let me go. They showed me they didn't care about me. And it forced me to care about myself and actually do my dream and do my thing. I resonate with this because it's what I did. And one of the challenges of the world we live in is we only see people in their glory. Corey, we don't tell our story. We don't tell how we got here. They only see us here. People only see me on this stage with these sneakers and this watch. And you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. And you don't know like I know what I went through to get to this place. Because I don't tell the story. I don't tell you that I was in Boston. My daddy had a big church in Boston. I was a senior associate. I bought 25 acres of land there. It's very interesting that we own 25 acres of land here because I bought 25 acres of land for the church there. I had a vision there. I had a plan there. I was preaching on Sundays there. I had a house there. I was making six figures there. I was doing well there. I owned property there. I owned real estate property there. I own real estate property that right now is worth millions of dollars. I left it. At the time it wasn't, because we're talking about, wasn't worth millions now. Somebody said to me, "Ooh, do you know how much that house is worth now?" And I said, "I know, and I don't want to know, because I want to be able to sleep tonight." But I walked away from my plan, chasing the will of God for my life, chasing the purpose of God in my life. I moved to a place I did not know. I didn't know none of y'all. Didn't none of y'all know me. I had never been to North Carolina. I'm not from here. I didn't go to Duke. I didn't go to Carolina. I wasn't in the military. No, God told me to come to North Carolina. And I left my home and my house. I sold. I lost money. When I got here, I took a job teaching at Neal Middle School, making $30,000 a year, teaching kids that didn't even want to learn, and driving a hoopty. Don't tell me that I'm balling now and you don't know what I went through to get here. Stepped out on faith. I bet on myself. I took a risk and believed that the God I served was able to deliver me and he would use me. And I didn't know nobody here and didn't nobody know me here. And people told me, "I can't believe you came to Durham to start a church. You can't have no big church in Durham." And I said, "You can't have no big church in Durham because you think like that. But you better watch me and see what God's about to do. Because the God I serve is able." I need a witness in the building. In 5 years, I had 5,000 people. People didn't like me, and they don't got to like me, because folk won't like you if you ever decide to bet on God. And you ever decide to put your trust in him, people gonna be mad at you. God turned my darkness into day. I worked at that school at the end of the first year. The principal said to me, "You coming back?" The end of the summer, he said, "You coming back?" I said, "Well, you know, my church is starting to get going. And, you know, if I have 300 people by the end of this first year, then I won't be able to come back." He said, "See you next year." "No, you ain't got to ooh," because I was like, "Yeah, save my spot." Because more than 300 people in 1 year, that's pretty crazy. But at the end of that year, Elder Clark, you were there. I had more than 300 people. And I went down and I said to him, "Hey," I said, "listen, I'm not going to be able to come back." He said, "What are you talking about?" I said, "Yeah, I can't come back." He said, "You mean to tell me that at the end of 1 year, you have more than 350 people?" See, you don't know anybody else's decreased story until they tell you how they were at a high place. I need a witness. And then they came down and they went through a low place and they walked through the valley for a little bit. And they were worried and they were scared and they were concerned. And wasn't nobody coming to the church. But you believed. I believe. It's hard to be successful if you can't make this kind of movement. You got to be careful not getting too hung up on what they pay you right now and building too much of a life based on what they pay you right now. Because if you build too much of a life based on what you're being paid now, you may stop yourself from being able to decrease to increase. The Bible says that Abraham, when called to leave home, family, what he was familiar with, stuff around him that he knew, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. This is another aspect of it. And I'm going to say this and I'll just be done because I'm out of time. But this is good. I'll pick it up next week. But one of the other challenges of walking with God is he don't always tell you where you're going. Can I get a witness in the building? Can I get a witness online? He don't always tell you. He'll say, I'm going to take you to a place where I'm going to show you. And if you want all the details, you won't go. If you want all, he's not going to tell you everything at the end. Sometimes you just end up packing up and saying, well, where are we going, Lord? And you don't know how it's going to happen. You don't know how you're going to make it. You don't know how it's going to take place. If you can't walk in a certain amount of ignorance and blindness, you can't walk with God, because God isn't going to tell you everything. And I hope and pray that you had parents and a mama like mine who trained you for this. Because I had a mama who didn't answer all my questions. I had parents that said, stay out of grown folks' business. I wish I had a witness in the building. Stop sitting here staring down my throat while I'm talking on the phone. Ain't nobody talking to you. This is grown folk talk. And now you asking questions. When are we going to get there? And if you ask it more than once, they'll look at you like you about to get popped. Don't ask me again when we're going to get there. We get there when we get there. Because they weren't on your schedule. You were on theirs. Anybody have parents like that? If you ask, can we go there? They'd say, we'll see. We'll see means if it fits in my schedule, if I'm not tired, if my bunions ain't hurting me, and if I have gas in the car, I might take you. Ain't nobody making no promises to you. Now, we want to get down at eye level and give five-year-old people full explanations that they can't understand. Just get it. You will have a hard time walking with God, and you'll set that baby up to have a hard time walking with God if you can't tell them, don't worry about where we're going. Don't worry about when we're going to get home. I was around somebody, and some little three-year-old said, I'm ready to go. I looked over there. You are ready to go. Excuse me, little girl. Ain't nobody on your timeline. Don't nobody care what your schedule is. You will go when they're ready for you. I cussed her out. No, I didn't cuss her out. But I fussed at that little girl so bad right in front of her parents. I said, you're ready to go, little girl. Don't nobody care when you're ready to do nothing. You're three. Know your place, mind your business. Sit down over there and be glad you got some juice in your cup and not water. You are ready to go. The devil is a liar. I wish I had a witness. Some of y'all, your mama would have knocked you out if you told her, I'm ready to go. You fell asleep in the back of the church. Your mama up in the front talking to everybody, talking to Sister Linda. If you ever walked down and said, Mom, I'm ready to go, you'd have woke up in the hospital. Anyway, what I'm saying is just know walking with God, he ain't telling you everything. You ever talk to these people who God just tells them everything? See, God told me that you were going to say that to me. Oh, he did? Then why don't you have an answer? God don't tell you everything. He said to Abraham, I'm going to take you to a place I'm going to show you. He said to Abraham, you know what? Take your son Isaac and sacrifice him on a mountain. I'll show you. I don't think we understand how crazy that is. There's no 7-Elevens. He goes to the servants and say, we get ready to go on a trip to do some sacrificing. They say, how long are we going to be gone? He said, I don't know. Where are we going? He said, I don't know. God will show me when we get there. He went to Sarah. He said, hey, Sarah, I'm getting ready to go on a trip taking Isaac. She said, that's my baby. Where are you taking my baby? He said, I don't know. She said, what you mean you don't know where you are taking my son? Where is my son going to be? He said, me and the boy are going to go worship and we'll come back. She said, when? He said, I don't know. Because he was looking for where God was going to show him. Because God was requiring that he do something hard. But God knew which mountain had the ram stuck in the thicket on it. And so he couldn't know till he got there. Movement. The power to move. It's not just the power to move. It's the power to move. For you not know where you're not sure where you're going. But a key to success in life is being able to trust God, not give way to fear, step on out and believe that he's got something greater for you. It's a trait that we have to inherit from Abraham. It's movement. Put your hands together if you heard a word from the Lord. Hallelujah. Can I pray for you really quickly before we take up the second offering? Let me pray. Lord, I just pray that we would receive the blessings of Abraham, that they'll come to the Gentiles by faith. I pray, Lord God, that by faith we'll receive the promise of the Spirit. God, we can't inherit Abraham's things, but we can inherit this trait. And God, we pray that this trait, this courage to come down from our mountains, walk through our valleys, and to live in a place that is our inheritance. God, I pray that you'd fill us full of that courage. God, I pray that you'd give us wisdom. God, I pray that you would empower us in the room and literally around the world. That, God, we would walk by faith and not by sight, and that we would have the faith of Abraham, the faith that calls those things that be not as though they were. We surrender our lives to your will for us. We are of the seed of Abraham. We have faith. We are of the seed of Abraham. And so, God, we pray that Abraham's blessings will be so real in our lives that people will notice it and will praise you, what you do, what you say. You're worthy in Jesus' name. We all sit together. Amen. Can I get you to give really quickly? If you can just, we were doing this building fund offering, and I know if you know me, and for years and years and years, we didn't take up a second offering, but we are on our way to this Victory Park. We're about to break ground and by the September, October, we're supposed to break ground, and it's about two and a half miles from here. We've got about 25 acres, and we're about to build this building. And it's going to be something really special. We're going to have a sanctuary in there that's going to be about this size. And then there's going to be basketball courts in this space for children. There's going to be a cafe in there and this big children's play space thing. And it's going to be something that's going to not only be our final home for our church, and we're going to have a state-of-the-art worship center there, but also it's going to be able to impact the community, and it's going to generate its own income. And so we have been sowing and giving, and so I'm inviting you to give and giving you an opportunity to sow into the work of the kingdom of God, because you can't beat God giving. And a part of the way that your life has meaning is that you sacrifice to something greater than yourself. You take a picture of that. If you're watching live around the world, take a picture of that. It'll, that little QR codes take you right to all of the ways in which you can give on the app, through Zelle, all the ways that you can give to the work of the kingdom of God. And you can be faithful, not just in your tithes, but in your offerings, above and beyond what you give in your tithe. But we give an offering to the house of God, and then we expect a blessing to happen as a result of it, and it's sowing seed into the work of the kingdom of God. And if you give my way a check, you can make a check payable to WOCC. You're watching around the world. Some of you, you're about to give the biggest gift that you can give. Thank you. Everything that you're giving is going to our building fund. It's not coming to me. And at some point, you make a decision to sow your seed, not just eat it. My sons and I, we had this great conversation I told you about. We had a great conversation, and we just hugged and we all straightened, apologized to each other, and we're all good. And then we started to have a conversation about whether or not they're going to eat the seed I give them or sow the seed that I give them. Because in your immaturity, you just want to eat your seed. Everything you get, you just want to eat it. But when maturity hits you, you start looking at that seed and you start thinking to yourself, what would happen with this if I sowed it? What would happen with this if I invested it? What would happen with this if instead of me spending it on me, I put it into something that turned into something? I told my sons, I don't want you guys to go to college so you can get a job. I want you to go to college so you can expand and grow so we can do business. Nobody care about you getting a job. I wanted you to go to school so you can expand your mind and go through a process so that we can do business together. So that the seed I give you won't just be something you eat, but it'll be something that you decide, ooh, let's sow that and let's turn it into something more. That's a part of what we're doing in church. We get a chance to practice it. Shouldn't be hard for us to practice it in the world since we practice it in church. Right now, we're all coming together. We give 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70,000, 80,000, a million. You give a million. You give in this offering, and you're deciding to sow into something and not just eat it. And God promises, hey, if you do that, if you sow into the kingdom, if you seek it first, I promise you everything else will be added unto you as well. In this room and around the world, we can give to the work of the kingdom of God. Come on, let's pray. Lord, thank you for this opportunity that we have to give. Thank you for this opportunity that we have to sow. We ask you to bless both gift and giver in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord God, that you will take this offering and multiply it supernaturally to the upbuilding of your kingdom. Lord, you know the price of steel. You know the price of concrete. You know the price of glass. You know all the stuff that's going on. And Lord God, you are able to do exceedingly abundantly above anything we could ever ask or think. And so, God, we're praying for money to come. And Lord, I'm praying that you'll bless your people. I'm praying that the people in the room will be so blessed that they'll be tired of hearing me talk about this and be so blessed and so rich that they just give me the money so that we can do this just to shut me up. God, I pray that the folk watching around the world will be so blessed, so supernaturally, so exponentially, that they can be a blessing and just to serve the kingdom, just to bless the kingdom, just so that the preachers don't gotta beg for stuff. Lord, that you will bless them so much that it'll be easy for them to sow and easy for them to give. Thank you for that. Thank you that Abraham's blessings belong to us. And I pray, Lord God, that that trait would fall on us, the trait of generosity. And we'll praise you for what you do, for what you say, for what you make of us. God, you're worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. We all sit together. God bless you as you give. Just let the bucket pass you and we'll be dismissed. And thank you so much for coming to worship with us in church. And you're watching live stream around the world. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Appreciate your faithfulness, your consistency, and your giving to the work of the kingdom of God. And all that takes place in this room, these spaces, happen as a result of people in their faithfulness and their generosity. And we appreciate your consistency to give to the work of the kingdom of God. We're praying and believing God's best in your life. Hallelujah. So many things are happening with us here at World Overcomers. There's always something in the bulletin. There's always something to talk about. I saw the announcement for end of year revival and all of the things that are taking place. We're just determined that you'll hear not just one voice and that you will be encouraged to believe God for the great things that he can do in your life. Hallelujah. Jump on your feet real quick. Let's be dismissed. Lord, we just want to thank you, praise you. We ask you to dismiss us from this place and up from your presence. For everyone that's watching around the world, God, dismiss us as we turn our stuff off, our machines off. God, as we're about to leave from this place, we pray that you would use us for your glory, bring us back here next Sunday. We're talking about Abraham right now and his traits and the blessings that belong to us. And we're believing for greater and bigger and more. Our faith says it's already done. God, we ask you to bless your people. Make your face shine upon your people. Be gracious to your people and give them peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, we all sit together. Amen. God bless you. Greet somebody in the name of the Lord. Thanks for coming to church today. Thanks for tuning in with us today. God bless you.
You're the heir to the promise God made to Abraham. Go get your inheritance. Anybody gonna go get it out there?